says in Galatians chapter 5, it says, verse 13, for brethren, you are being called unto liberty, only use not your liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another. For all the Lord is fulfilled in one word, even this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. But if you bite and devour one another, take heed that you be not consumed one another. So the Bible's warning here about gossiping and fighting, infighting. It says, this I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. So we're to walk in the Spirit and not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. These are contrary one to the other, so that you cannot do the things that you would. But if you be led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. So the Bible teaches us the importance of walking in the Spirit. It's to walk in the Spirit of God. It says, now the works of the flesh are manifest. This is in Galatians chapter 5, verse 19. It says, now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these. Adultery is of the flesh. Fornication is of the flesh. Uncleanliness is of the flesh. Lasciviousness is of the flesh. Idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulation, wrath, strife, seditions, envyings, murders, drunkenness, reveling, of such like, of which I tell you before, as I have also told you in times past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. So here the Bible warns us the kind of life that we should be living and the life that we do not want to walk down. So it says in Galatians chapter 5, verse 16, thus I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. That in our hearts we have the lust of the flesh, that there are things in our hearts that we desire from the flesh. And Paul, in the Holy Bible, is saying not to walk in the flesh, but to walk in the Spirit of God. And then it tells us what walking in the flesh is. Now, the works of the flesh are manifest, which is adultery, fornication, uncleanliness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulation, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of which I tell you before, as I have also told you in times past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. So the Bible says, if we walk in witchcraft, if we walk in adultery, if we walk in hatred, if we walk in murder, if we walk in these things, then we'll have no future in the kingdom of God. Envyings, murders, drunkenness, reveling of such like. Also, I told you in time past that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. So if we continue to do these things, if we continue to get drunk, if we continue to sleep around and commit adultery, if we continue to backbite and have hate, if we continue to murder, even murder somebody's reputation with words, then we cannot enter the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, and faith. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, and peace. And when the Holy Spirit comes in your life, the Holy Spirit brings love, joy, and peace. And it begins by knowing that Christ was crucified for you. Knowing that the Lord of glory died on that cross to deliver you and forgive you of your sin. To deliver you and forgive you. To deliver you and forgive you of your sin. If you want to be delivered and forgiven of your sin, it is to know that Christ delivers you by his death. His crucifixion and death on that cross took your punishment for your sin. He shed his blood on that cross that you may be forgiven. And if you go to him, you can be forgiven, but you have to repent. You've got to turn away and repent for the things that you've done wrong. The Bible commands us to repent. The Bible commands us to repent. And if we repent and turn away from our old life and go to Jesus Christ and know that Jesus Christ shed his blood and took the wrath that you and I deserved, that Christ took that wrath. He took your wrath. In Isaiah 53, it says, he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. And he shed his blood that you may be forgiven today. In Galatians chapter 1, it says, Paul, an apostle, not of men, neither by man, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father who raised him from the dead, and all the brethren which are with me unto the churches of Galatia. Grace be unto you and peace from God the Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible offers you peace. It offers you the peace of God. The peace of God is there for you. But it cost the Son of God his own blood to provide that peace for you. It says in Romans chapter 5, it says, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And you can have that peace of God in your life, but it is to know how you get the peace. The peace was bought for you at the cross. Your peace that you can have was paid by the Son of God, and he paid it with his own blood. The blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin. And that blood was shed on the cross for you. And it says in the Word of God, it says, who gave himself for our sins that he might deliver us from this present evil world according to the will of God and our Father. It said, who gave himself for our sins. Who gave himself for our sins. When Christ came, he did not just come as a prophet. He was more than a prophet. He was the Son of God. But the principal mission of our Lord Jesus Christ was to give ourselves. He says here, who gave himself for our sins. He gave himself for our sins. That's why Christ came. Christ came because he gave himself for our sins. Now you might say, Jay, I'm good. I'm a good guy. I'm a good girl. I've done nothing wrong. I don't deserve to go to hell. I don't want your message. It's just Bible bashing. And Jay, I'm not interested. But it says here, who gave himself for our sins. That Jesus Christ's mission was not to set up a soup kitchen. His mission was to give himself for our sins. He died for us. Hey, bro, you all right? You all right? Do you want me to turn the camera? Do you want to ask a question?
No, it's all right, bro.
All right, man.
I wonder what the camera was for.
Well, it's number one, it's security, because anybody says we're homophobic or this, that, and the other, we got it on here.
Oh, okay.
You know? Secondly, we tape it as well. We put it on YouTube at some time, yeah? All right, man. Who gave himself for our sins. That's his message, and that is why he came. And when he says he gave himself for our sins, it means he gave himself for your sin. You said, Jay, I'm not a sinner. Well, the Bible says all fall short of the glory of God. The Bible says that. You said, Jay, I'm not into the Bible. But that's what the Bible says. You said, Jay, you're condemning me. No. If I believe in hell, if I really believe in hell, should I not be out here telling you about Jesus? If I don't believe in hell, I should be at home. But because I believe in hell, I'm out here throwing out armbands for you to get saved. Because I really believe it. And he says here, who gave himself for our sins. They took Jesus Christ. They took Jesus Christ. And they nailed him to that cross. Before they nailed him, they whipped him. Before they nailed him, they mocked him. They laughed at him. They whipped his back. They mocked him. They humiliated him. They put a crown of thorns on his head. They laughed at him. And then they threw him up on that cross. But when Christ was dying on that cross, he gave himself for our sins. He took your wrath and punishment. In his love for you, he took your wrath and punishment for your sins, for the things that you've done against the Lord of God. He gave himself for our sins to deliver us from this present evil world according to the will of God and our Father, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel. You see, they'd had the gospel, but they wanted something else. They wanted religion. They wanted entertainment. They wanted rules and regulations. They didn't want Jesus Christ and the simplicity of believing in him. And the gospel is simple. The gospel of Jesus Christ is simple. It's believe on Jesus Christ for your forgiveness. To believe on Jesus Christ and know that he died on that cross. And if you trust him and know that he died on that cross, you can know what it is to be a child of God. It's so simple a child could believe it. That Jesus Christ is the Savior. That is the gospel. And God wants you to repent. He wants you to turn away from that which you know is wrong. He wants you to turn away from it. And leave it alone and hate it. And turn away from that which is wrong, whatever it is. And flee to Jesus Christ. And find that you can be forgiven. The Bible says you become a new creature in Christ. The Bible says you become a son of God. The Bible says you become born again. The Bible says that you become a new creature in Christ. The Bible says that you become saved. The Bible says you were lost but now are found when you believe in Jesus Christ. When you trust him as your Lord and Savior, that's what the Bible says. The Bible says this. The authority of the Word of God says to you today, the Bible says, if you believe in Jesus Christ, you shall be saved. But the Bible says there'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth. The Bible warns of a hell. The Bible warns of a judgment to come. The Bible warns of a terrible end of this world. The Bible warns of a hell. Jesus said there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. The Bible says the wrath of God is coming. The Bible says we are children of wrath if we disobey God. The Bible says these things. The Bible says nobody will enter the kingdom of God if we continue to lie, continue to sleep around, continue to cheat, continue to gossip, continue to murder, and do anything that's against the Word of God and rebel against God. The Bible warns us there is no future, but only a terrible hell. The Bible warns it. But the Bible says that there is no name under heaven and earth that which you'll be saved but Jesus Christ. The Bible warns that the only person can save you is Jesus Christ. The Bible warns that Jesus Christ is the gospel of God, the good news. The Bible teaches that the only way to heaven is Jesus Christ. No other way, no other prophet, no other religion, no other ideology, nothing can save you but Him. He is the only one that can save you. Jesus Christ, the Savior. Only He can save you. Only He can set you free. Hey guys, do you want to ask a question? Do you want me to turn this off?